now on BBC 4, John Grundy travels with Pevsner to Northumberland.
Between 1949 and 1974, Professor Nicholas Pevsner, a German emigre art historian, toured the counties of England, compiling a 46-volume guide to every building he thought was of interest, from Stonehenge to Centre Point.
Well, that is a puzzle. Can you have an 1190-looking arch on capitals which look 1220?
Pevsner's guides, regularly updated, are unique. Nothing quite like them exist anywhere else in the world.
Well, now for burial. Mind that dog.
In this series, six contemporary travellers take to the road with Pevsner's Buildings of England as their guide.
Northumberland is a rough county. That is its great attraction. Rough are the winds and rough the castles. Rough the moors and rough the miners and rough the stone. And rough the dolerite cliffs by the coast and by the Roman wall.
Pevsner was right. Northumberland is a rough county. Though I don't think we Northumbrians are all that rough, not anymore. And if we once were, well, this is a border county, and life here has been hard. Over on the east, the wind blows off the North Sea across the moors. And up to the north, on the border, the Northumbrians fought against the Scots, on and off, for centuries.
It's been a border county since the 2nd century, when the Romans decided to separate the conquered southerners from the barbarians in the north.
And this is their border fence, Hadrian's Wall, built of fine sandstone blocks and stretching 73 miles from Bowness near Carlisle in the west to Wall's End near Newcastle in the east. And in this particular central section, they ran it along the top of volcanic cliffs to give it that extra bit of defensive strength.
The wall was both a fighting platform and a frontier. Every 7 miles was a fort, and every mile a mile castle for about 30 troops, which acted as a controlled gateway.
It was also a way of trapping the enemy. Troops would come charging out of the north gate of the mile castle out into no man's land and surround the attackers and pin them back against the wall.
Above all, it was a symbol of control, a sort of Berlin Wall, meant to frighten off those outside it and cow those inside it. As in Berlin, the same native population existed on both sides of the wall, and the wall was the alien army's way of keeping them apart. If the Roman wall turned Northumberland into a military border, there is a sense in which the county became part of another frontier. In the battle to spread Christianity across England, the landing beach was over on the county's northeast coast.
From the mainland, Holy Island or Lindisfarne is not an impressive sight. The island is flat, and the sands of a laguna separated from its foreground. Yet one cannot help a feeling of awe as one treads the ground of Holy Island.
There is a feeling of awe here. The flatness of the sands and the vastness of the sky give it a sort of transcendental monotony. But the feeling comes also from the island's extraordinary history as a religious settlement. David Adam came here 9 years ago.
It's the saints of old that have made it special. Began with Aidan in 635 and him founding a little monastery on this island with 12 monks and 12 lads to learn. And they'd have to learn the Psalms off by heart, all 150 of them, and a gospel off by heart, before they did anything else. And these were lads who dedicated themselves like soldiers.
St. Cuthbert built himself a hermitage out on these rocks, cut off like the island itself at high tide. In his honour, the community made the Lindisfarne Gospels, illuminated with a Celtic love of pattern, spirals and scrolls, and animals entwined in the text.
Nearly all this country was Celtic before the Anglo-Saxons came, and it's the early Christianity of the island. And because it was early, it was relatively simple, and it didn't have all the layers of building up that we've tended to build up on over the centuries. So the prayers were basic prayers for saying in your home, for saying when you were milking, for saying when you were working, instead of keep coming back to church.
There are few actual remains of Cuthbert's time, but the later bits which do survive seem to illustrate the story just as well. It doesn't seem to matter that this priory was built hundreds of years later by monks of a very different type.
The priory church makes a glorious ruin. The stone is dark red and has weathered into the most curious vermiculated surfaces. There is enough standing for the buildings to be of both intense architectural interest and eminently picturesque interest against the background of fields and the sea beyond.
I was given my first copy of Pevsner when I was about 16, and at first I was fascinated but mystified. I spent ages trying to work out what a nookshaft was, or why one window was deck and another one was perp. I know there are people who'd like to kick him for his cool, pedantic precision, but I'm not one of them. He gives you the facts, not just the bald facts, but supported by a towering breadth of vision and experience. So when, for example, he writes about the priory and says, the geometrical motifs between the columns are lively enough to exclude a date earlier than about 1135. You believe him. Not 1150, not 1125, 1135. What a man.
25 years later, I helped revise the Northumberland edition. What an opportunity, but scary, having to match that style. Even worse, having to match that accuracy. The great castle at the other side of the harbour was largely built of stones stolen from the priory. It was built to protect the harbour against attack by the Scots, but they never came, and the castle fell into decay.
And then in 1901, Edward Hudson, who was the founder of Country Life magazine, came on holiday in the northeast, saw the castle, and was intrigued. Apparently, he scaled these walls. He must have been extraordinarily adventurous. What he discovered inside was tatty and derelict, but he had the vision to see its potential, so he persuaded the government to sell it to him.
Edwin Lutyens was the architect that he chose to do it up for him. Lutyens had made his name building country houses in the southeast. Before 1902, when he came to work on Holy Island, he'd never done anything like this. And yet, he responded wonderfully to the wild stoniness of the place.
This room was probably the gunpowder store of the castle, and its basic shape, with this tunnel-vaulted ceiling and the thickness of the stone walls, is original. What Lutyens added was this great fireplace that fills the whole of one end wall. And then he softened the effect with a couple of charming windows in his own version of the Gothic style. I love the abstract simplicity of that stained glass, There's no slavish copying of the Middle Ages here. What Lutyens is doing is reinventing the Gothic style to make it suitable for the 20th century.
Even in a comparatively small space, Lutyens could create the most elegant perspectives. And his floors are so beautiful. This one in the gallery mingles the textures of stone and brick with this herringbone pattern, which he used both inside and outside the castle. He cared about detail, like these lovely oak door catches weighted with lead.
The house is now a vision of passages hewn into the rock, of large vaulted chambers, of short, strong, circular piers and low arches. Nothing vast, but romantic.
Lutyens' collaborator, the great gardener Gertrude Jekyll, was asked to do a garden underneath these crags on the landward side of the castle. But she, like Lutyens, was sensitive to the natural drama of the site, and so she chose instead to use the rocks that the castle's perched on as her flower beds. She had a lad from the village lowered down the cliffs in a basket so that he could plant wild flowers among the rocks. A lot of visitors come to Holy Island expecting a sort of Dark Age austerity, and they're shocked to find these architectural jewels surrounded by more humble things, like pubs and guest houses, and ordinary cottages. Most of these buildings, like the castle, are made of snaffled priory stone, so there's a continuity here. Even the big, most unsuitable dormer windows tell you that this is a place to live in, not just to experience a holy awe. To admit a rather shameful fact, what I particularly like about Holy Island isn't so much the great monuments as the ordinary places. These upturned boats are the remnants of the Lindisfarne herring fleet of the late 1800s. Instead of being thrown away, they were hauled up, turned over, put to good use. Nobody's tarted these up. They're still surrounded by piles of fishermen's tat. They charmed Lutyens too, and he pinched three of them as sheds for the castle. His, of course, are tasteful and beautifully grouped. Holy Island is a place where architecture and the spirit come together. But there aren't many of those in Northumberland. There's been too much fighting. In the 13th century, however, there was a little window of peace when almost all of the great churches of the county were built, like the Priory Church at Hexham. But to fully appreciate Hexham, it's necessary to go way back beyond the 13th century. In fact, you've got to go back to the very first church that was built on this site, about the year 675 AD, by St. Wilfrid. Wilfrid was a northeasterner, born and bred, the son of a Saxon nobleman, who as a young man travelled to Rome. He came back from Rome with some relics of St. Andrew. This church is still dedicated to St. Andrew. And he also came back with the determination to build himself a church as great as the ones that he'd seen on his travels. All that remains of Wilfrid's church is down here.
A partly original stair gives access to the most moving monument of medieval Northumberland.
This is the main chamber of the crypt where Wilfrid would have displayed the relics of St. Andrew. Wilfrid was nothing if not a showman. He wanted to spread Christianity, and he felt that the best way to attract people was to impress them. So you can imagine the intense drama that there must have been in the dark,
rather claustrophobic mystery of this tiny little room with the relics of the saint encased about here in their jeweled casket, framed on either side by oil lamps in these two niches. This crypt is built of Roman stones looted from the nearby abandoned Roman settlement of Corstorpitan at Corbridge. Stones like this are part of the giveaway, carved in a sort of diamond brooching in order to allow plaster or cement to stick to the surface like it has done here. But one of the most moving things down here is the way the stones have been used without any regard or understanding of their original purpose. So, for example, these must have been part of quite a sophisticated building, with their cima recta moulding there, a proper classical moulding, and this lovely little frieze up above, but they're used here completely out of context. And here's an inscription to Imperator Caesar, the Emperor Caesar Lucius Septimus Severus Pius Pertinax. It's rather difficult to read now, but very, very important chap, but just stuck here at random. Just another brick in the wall.
Upstairs, even though it's much later, the sense of the primitive lingers in these 15th century figures.
About it as far as churches are concerned. The window of peace was about to be closed. In 1296, Edward I started a war against the Scots, which was to last for almost 400 years and turn this beautiful county into one of the most violent borders in history, utterly affecting the lives of its inhabitants and the buildings that they lived in. The gaunt ruins of Dunstanborough on their Dolerite promontory are one of the most moving sights of Northumberland. If you recognise the sonorous tones of Pevsner there, I quoted them because I agree with them. This place is deeply moving. It was begun in 1314, the year of the Battle of Bannockburn, when the English were trounced by the Scots, and it's built on the most ideal site.
In places, the cliffs are so high that it wasn't even necessary to build a wall. But where they were needed, the defences are powerful and dramatic.
But the gentler approach from the south is without natural defences, and so has been given a gigantic gatehouse with a pair of huge drum-shaped towers flanking the entrance.
It might seem odd that the entrance should be on the side that's the most easy to attack from the land, and that the castle is so empty in the middle. But its shape is defined by the landscape. The cliffs define it on three sides, while on the other, the boundary defends the little bay that acted as the castle's harbour. By the late 1500s, the borders had developed a culture of feuding and cattle rustling. The rest of England settled down to a comfy and respectable time, building houses like Longleat or Montacute. So, what were Northumbrians building?
This is a bastle. Northumberland's unique contribution to English architecture, from the same source as the French word bastille. The very word sounds aggressive. A bastle is a small, defensible building, the ultimate response to life on the violent edge.
It's unique because it's a defensible building which combines under one roof accommodation for animals on the ground floor with accommodation for humans up above. Just look at this extraordinary stonework. The whole wall is built of random boulders, roughly coursed in crude rows. These stones are gargantuan, cyclopean, bonded together with lime plaster and galleted with little pieces of stone to fill up the spaces. These steps up to the upper doorway weren't added until later. They're not bonded into the original stonework. They sort of lean against it. Until they were built, the only way into the living quarters up here was by a ladder which you had to pull up after you. Just look at the thickness of that wall. That's almost 4 feet thick. And behind the door, there's a great drawbar tunnel, deep set into the wall to hold an oak beam so that you could lock the door onto whatever marauders were trying to force their way in. And inside? Well, this is it. One room for all of the people who lived here, who would have had to been quite wealthy to build something as solid as this. A couple of tiny windows, because windows were vulnerable. Better to live in the dark. And these are the quarters of the cattle, because they needed their fortress too. Some of these basal byres have got low stone tunnel vaults, but others are like this, with huge, transverse, close-set oak beams. Virtually tree trunks, in fact. There are no windows at all, and there's an incredible sense of weight. This is all very oppressive and primitive, and very Northumbrian. Scotland and England were united in 1603, but it was a long time before Northumbrians found the confidence to build with something other than defence in mind.
Wallington, built by Sir William Blackett in 1688 on the proceeds of mining, shipping and Whig convictions.
The east front of Wallington is cool and classical, with tall windows rather close together. And they're sash windows, which was quite a revolution in 1688 because they'd only recently been invented. Most of the windows on this front have been replaced, but this one must be original because it's blocked up behind early 18th century panelling. These old glazing bars are thick and plain and the panes of glass are square. But the later replacement windows have got much thinner glazing bars, much more delicately moulded. This later, more refined style is even more evident round the corner on the south front, remodelled half a century later, with its delicately moulded pediments and window surrounds. The windows themselves are widely spaced. This is all very subtle, surprisingly rich for the period, and a bit of a preparation for what comes inside.
The principal rooms were redecorated in a more fashionable, courtly style than the county had known before. A gang of Italian stuccatori was established in 1742, while some of the best English marble carvers did the fireplaces.
This gang of Italian stuccatori sounds rather awesome. Pundits, perhaps, or football supporters. In fact, they were fancy plasterers, specialists in stucco, who settled in the nearby village. This is the Rococo style, civilized, witty, light-hearted. And this is about as good as you can find anywhere. By the middle of the 18th century, Northumberland had finally caught up with the rest of England. Its border history was forgotten about, its wild ways a thing of the past. In Northumberland, as in the rest of England, the world was being tamed. Maybe. Just when nice urbane houses were being built everywhere and nicely tamed gardens laid out, the Duke of Northumberland created a pleasure ground near his castle at Alnwick, which revealed that the taste for wildness hadn't quite died out. The remarkable thing about Holme is that the Duke decided to turn it into a pleasure ground with rooms for hunting banquets and summer picnics. And so inside the walls there's a mixture of genuine medieval remains and pretend Gothic buildings, which in the 1770s and 80s he had his architects Robert Adam and Capability Brown scatter among the ruins for him. The mid-18th century didn't have much understanding of genuine Gothic buildings, so it's pretty easy to tell which is genuine and which is Gothic revival. Genuine Gothic arches, worn and steeply pointed. 18th century Gothic ones, smooth, Tudor style. Genuine medieval gateway, plain and severe. 18th century Gothic gatehouse, pretty and light-hearted. Genuine medieval lavatorium. 18th century Gothic lavatory, complete with arrow slits to repel boarders. And Robert Adam's summer house is equally unlike a genuine medieval building. 18th century Gothic revivalists were much less concerned with historical accuracy than with trying to create a style which was rich and decorative. An arrangement like this of a doorway with flanking windows would never have been seen in a genuine medieval building, but it's such a pretty example. Holme was created just when an extraordinary sea change occurred in people's attitude to art and history. The 18th century suddenly seemed to get fed up with the civilized world that it was creating and began to yearn for something wilder. The past, once a desert that nobody cared about, now became something to inspire and intrigue. The first Duke's father would probably have pulled down his tatty old ruin, but his son allowed himself to be stirred by it. It was a process that went on, of course, all over the country, but Northumbrians seemed to have jumped at it with more gusto than most. But the 18th century was selective about what it admired in nature. For the sea, Northumbrians have always felt as much fear as admiration. This beautiful coast is treacherous too. Here on the Farne Islands, St Cuthbert lived as a hermit. But the islands have been the nemesis of hundreds of seafarers.
Long Stone Lighthouse, 1826, by David Alexander, for Trinity House, Newcastle.
This room on the fourth floor, just underneath the lantern, is only 10 feet across. And it was in here on the 7th of September, 1838, at 4:45 in the morning, that the lighthouse keeper's daughter, Grace Darling, first looked out of the window and spotted the wreck of the SS Forfarshire, which had just struck the corner of the island called Big Harker.
She could see people clinging to the rocks. With her father, she rowed across a mile of raging seas to rescue them.
She didn't take anything away from Grace Darling. She did a good job for a young girl, and dangerous it would be. And from here to where the wreck was on the Big Harkers, I've rowed it myself in a small boat on a fine day, and it's a bit of a breathtaking row. And she was just a young girl with her father.
Grace Darling's feat of heroism caught the Victorian imagination, and she became embroiled in a sentimental media frenzy. She was invited to appear at the Adelphi Theatre in London in an extravaganza called Wreck at Sea. She turned it down. For 4 years, she lived quietly at the lighthouse, despite the fact that boat trips were organised to see her.
In Bamborough Churchyard, monument to Grace Darling, a Gothic shrine with metal colonnettes and a recumbent effigy.
At the age of 26, she died of consumption.
There was a huge swell of public sympathy in Victorian breasts, and they built this rather splendid little shrine to her, far grander than anything normally afforded to a humble village girl and a lighthouse keeper's daughter. But Northumberland has other, more practical monuments to safety at sea. My favourite is at the mouth of the Tyne, always a notoriously dangerous place. The problem was a set of rocks in the middle of the river called the Black Middens. Overlooking them is the watchhouse of the Tynemouth Volunteer Life Brigade. It was built by a chap with a good Geordie name, C.T. Gomachinsky, the borough engineer. Pevsner doesn't mention it, but to me, it's a model of what a seaside building should look like. Weatherboarded like a rowing boat, and brightly painted in traditional Coast Guard colours. Although it's still a working watchhouse, inside, the volunteers seem to have kept everything they've ever used or salvaged. And they've turned it into a collection which just oozes with pride at their achievements and history. The brigade was founded by John Morrison after he witnessed a terrible wreck on the Black Middens and formed a team of trained volunteers to assist the Coast Guard.
Well, the museum started actually with the wrecks of ships. After the men in here would go out and take the crews off the stricken ships, of course they would get the spoils afterwards. If a figurehead was washing around on the rocks, it would be fetched up and put into the brigade. And of course, names of ships and bits and pieces, and actually grew their own museum. It wasn't put there, it grew by the men who worked on the wrecks. Barrels above the head, they've all saved a life, every one of them. The most important one would be the wooden barrel, as it was a ketch, and it was on its way from Amsterdam to Newcastle with the roofing slates, pan tile, the Dutch roofing slates, and she got into difficulties, and she was imminent of turning turtle, and what they did there in desperation, they lashed the five-year-old daughter to that barrel. And of course she went over with the loss of all hands but her. And she was washed into the haven. And of course one of the crew actually spotted her and waded out and managed to get her ashore and saved her life. And she was the only survivor. I went to sea when I was 14, and I've been at sea most of my life. And I can feel everything in here. what's happened to the crews and the artifacts, and I'm very honoured to work here and be part of it. As an old sea dog, I suppose, I love it.
Though Northumberland is a wild and rural county, the city of Newcastle on its southern edge has been a vibrant place since the Middle Ages. On the steep north bank of the Tyne, Newcastle developed a jumble of buildings which are among the most exciting urban views in Britain. The overall effect is pure historic English town, but parts of it could even be New York. This soaring townscape of brownstone blocks huddled under the mighty engineering of bridges.
This is perhaps the most exciting visual experience of Newcastle. The most violent contrasts of level are met with everywhere. Bridges high overhead, 100 steps winding their way down, houses rising on top of houses.
Newcastle was essentially a medieval town. Then in the late 18th century, with the onset of the Industrial Revolution, it went into a sort of economic overdrive and set about reinventing itself. It had always been a wealthy provincial town, but suddenly it began to see itself in bigger terms as a sort of provincial capital and rebuild itself accordingly.
The reinvention of Newcastle was largely the work of a local developer, Richard Granger. By demolishing several acres of the city, much of it recently built, Granger provided Newcastle with an entirely new planned commercial centre in the 1830s. Grey Street is the culmination of the plan. It's one of the grandest streets in England, curving and rising, gradually unfolding new and finer vistas as it goes up. The Theatre Royal, with its splendid Corinthian portico, is one of the most imposing in the country.
But however grand these streets, this is, in a sense, stage-set architecture, skin-deep. Apart from the theatre, virtually none of Granger's buildings have got interiors which are worthy of their facades. Granger was a typical developer, much more interested in making a sale than in the fine details. But he has, nevertheless, left the city a remarkable legacy.
The city embraced the railway age with gusto and thought nothing of driving track through the middle of the ancient castle.
Can you imagine what an outcry that would cause nowadays, building a motorway, say, between the keep and the gatehouse of an ancient castle? People would explode in fury, and I would be one of them. But in Newcastle, it worked. Even the castle part worked. In England, castles are 10 a penny. But a castle with a railway line going through the middle of it.
And elsewhere, the savage onslaught of the railway produced marvellous moments, canyon-like chasms of bridges. The high-level bridge built by Robert Stephenson in 1845 was a brilliant way of avoiding having to run trains down the impossibly steep banks to cross the Tyne. The track has a road suspended underneath it, a prophetic image of steam trains lording it over the horse-drawn carriages underneath. Newcastle has been lucky with its bridges. Pevsner himself wasn't quite so sure, though.
The new Tyne Bridge, 1928. With huge concrete pylons and one large arch of steel anchored far below the roadway. The design is too heavy for the good of Newcastle. It shows its effort, far more than a steel suspension bridge would have done.
Pevsner doesn't often talk piffle, but that is piffle, isn't it? This fantastically muscular bridge has rightly become the unofficial symbol of the city, and the best-known and best-loved icon of the Northeast.
One of the most powerful figures in Victorian Newcastle was W.G. Armstrong, who made a fortune manufacturing ships and guns. He spent it building one of the greatest houses in Northumberland.
Cragside, designed by William Norman Shaw in 1870. The site is Wagnerian, and so here is Shaw's architecture.
Shaw, one of the few famous architects to have worked in Northumberland, was from Kent. The style he favoured in the 1870s was a sort of Old English style, a picturesque version of the houses of his local countryside, and one that was to get diluted in a million suburban semis. Cragside has the style at its finest and most powerful, but it's not Northumbrian. And yet, I love this place. I love the confident way that Shaw mixes features together. It's half timbered in places, which is a thing you just never find in a Northumbrian house. But on the other hand, it's got a tower, what you might call a peel tower, which is a nice northern touch. And it's got a classical cupola on the roof. And I love the way that he uses the landscape, hugging the rocks and almost growing out of the hillside. What a strength of personality Shaw must have had to drag all of these different elements together. Shaw was certainly capable of providing the sort of grandeur that you normally expect in a country house. Armstrong was a major industrialist, and he needed to entertain the great and the powerful of the world in order to seduce them into buying his armaments. And a room like this provided just the sort of setting in which to do it, with its overpoweringly splendid fireplace, 10 tons of Italian marble. The King of Siam, the Shah of Persia, the Crown Prince of Afghanistan, all spent the evening here. But in fact, the rest of the house isn't like that at all. The atmosphere is quite different. Shaw's skill and quality is still on display in room after room. Here in the library, there's the most wonderful mixture of richness and comfort. Stained glass panels by William Morris and Burne Jones cast a warm glow into the room. The ceiling is rich, heavy even, and yet the overall feeling of this room is so much cozier than you'd normally expect in a great house. It makes me wonder whether what we're seeing is a mixture of Shaw's personality and the needs and desires of Lord Armstrong. He wasn't an aristocrat, he never pretended to be. He was a hugely successful middle-class industrialist, and the house that he created is a modern home. Big, maybe, very big, in fact, but essentially a place to live in, a place to be comfortable in. Armstrong used the force of the water coursing through his vast estate to power a hydroelectric system which he invented himself. He was one of the most innovative men of his generation. He converted these lamps from oil to electricity in 1880, and this house, in fact, was the first house in the world to be given a permanent supply of electric lighting. The house is stuffed with gadgets. The electric dinner gongs, for example. And the kitchen is full of hydraulics, including a water-powered spit for roasting meat. He was the most amazing man, and he built an amazing house,
which manages to weld together all of the romance of the Border Hills with the most brilliant modern industrial inventiveness.
The 20th century has had little impact on rural Northumberland. If Pevsner went back there today, he wouldn't find much that has changed since he published his volume in 1957.
But the last few decades have transformed the appearance of Tyneside. Some of the transformations have been hideous. Ugly boxes rammed down in the 60s and 70s without any sense of context or scale or materials. But there are other developments which have been far more imaginative.
The Biker Wall is a wall of flats that flows and curves along the hillside. It's like a huge basalt. Outside, the wall is defensive, designed to protect the inhabitants from urban traffic. Inside, it turns the buildings in towards the community. The emphasis is on variety and differentiation, on small units that keep their domestic feel.
Take a row like this, for example. You wouldn't be surprised to find a row like this in some pretty seaside town, like Lindisfarne. But to find it on a council estate in Tyneside is a real delight. I started these travels at Hadrian's Wall, high up in the hills of rural Northumberland. And I'm ending them at the Biker Wall. The foundations of Hadrian's Wall run underneath Biker, just a few feet down. So here, on this one spot, we've got two buildings, 2,000 years apart, built for the same reason, for defence.
The history of Scotland's fishing industry by people who've lived it in 40 minutes. But first, more from Tyneside, charting its path from a city that famously didn't work to the artistic and architectural regional capital of today. That's next.
Life is good.